allusions to my professional duties are in doubtful taste. I didn't become a head jailer because I like head jailing. I didn't become an assistant tormentor because I like assistant tormenting. We can't all be sorcerers, you know. Ah, you brought that on yourself.
Colonel Fairfax is not a sorcerer. He's a man of science and of alchemy.
Well, whatever he is, he won't be one for long. For he's to be beheaded today for dealings with the devil. His master nearly had him last night when a fire broke out in Beecham Tower.
Oh, how I wish he had escaped in a conclusion. But take care. There's still time to reply to his petition for mercy.
I'm content to chance that. This evening at 7:30.
You're cruel, most of the speak so unfeelingly of the death of a young and handsome soldier.
Young and handsome? How did you know he was young and handsome?
Because I've seen him every day for weeks past taking his exercise on the beach of Tower.
Curse him.
There. I believe you're jealous of him now. Jealous of a man I've never spoken to. Jealous of a poor soul who's to die now.
I am. I'm jealous of everybody and everything. I'm jealous of the very words I speak to you, because they reach your ears, and I mustn't go near them.
How unjust you are! Jealous of the words you speak to me? Well, I know as well as I do. I don't even like them.
You used to like them.
I used to pretend I liked them. It was mere politeness to comparative strangers.
I don't believe you know what jealousy is. I don't believe you know how it eats into a man's heart and disorders his digestion and turns his interior into boiling lead. Oh, you are a heartless jade to trifle with the delicate organization of the human interior.
Oh, Busy today?
Busy? Aye. The fire in the beach room last night has given me work enough. A dozen poor prisoners. Richard Colfax, Sir Martin Byfleet, Colonel Fairfax, Warren the Preacher Poet, and half a score others, all packed into one small cell about 6 feet square. Well, Colonel Fairfax, who's to die today, is to be removed to number 14 in Cold Harbour, that he may have his last hour alone with his confessor. I, to see to that.
Poor gentleman. He'll die bravely. But wilt thou not be glad to welcome thy brave brother with the fame of whose exploits all England is a-ringing?
I truly think he brings the reprieve.
And not otherwise.
Well, he's a brave fellow, and I love brave men.
All brave men?
No, some that I verily believe. But I do hope Leonard will not be too strict with me. They say he is a very drunk and virtual circumspection. Now, my dear old father, it's kind of this stuff.
And leave thee pretty well to thine own ways, eh? Well, I've no fears for thee. Thou hast a feather brain, but thou art a good lad. Saved his flag and cut his way through 50 foes who thirsted for his life. He'll be well.
have not seen thee weep.
Halt! Colonel Fairfax, my old friend, we meet but sadly.
Sir, I greet you with all goodwill, and I thank you for the zealous care with which you guarded me from the pestilent dangers which threaten human life outside. In this happy little community, death, when it comes, doth so in a punctual and businesslike fashion, and like a courtly gentleman, giveth due notice of his advent, that one may not be taken unawares.
Sir, you bear this bravely, as a brave man should.
Why, sir, it is no light boon to die swiftly and surely. In a while, in fashion, truth to tell, I would gladly have my life. But if that may not be, I'll have the next best thing to it, which is death. Believe me, sir, my lot is not so much of it.
Oh, Father, I cannot bear
this. My poor lad.
Nay, pretty one, why weepest thou? Come, be comforted. Such a life as mine is not worth weeping for. hold my kinsman in abhorrence for the scurvy trick he has played me.
A thousand thanks, good sir. We shall meet on this spot in an hour or so. I shall be the bridegroom and your worship will wish me well. Till then.
Here's a brave man, and it is a pity that he should die. Now, how to find him a bride at such short notice? Well, the task should be easy.
Long.